Now I'd like to ask Dr. Poornima ma'am, what kind of psychological distress are all these impacts going to create on women, and how are they going to affect them?
So to start with, mental health, I think should be placed right on top of, the list of whiplashes that this pandemic has created for us. The mental process has been disturbed so badly that, this wave of mental illness is going to take on and continue for the next several years. The first thing that I'd like to mention here is that, both the other guests have said, Leela Garu and Pradeep Madam, that women are the ones who are most affected, and I completely agree with that, because the onus of maintaining the family, the onus of doing all the work within the family and make sure the family runs properly, the onus is on women. The onus of maintaining the family is on the woman. And be it an IT professional or a doctor like me or anybody, this no maid, no plumber, this domestic help situation, as probably we've not really, not having a maid for 2 or 3 days or not having domestic help for 2 or 3 days, we manage. But not having for 2 or 3 months when you have elderly people in the house or something like that. See, I live in a gated community where we have a lot of elderly people well into their 70s and 80s who don't have any support because the children are in America. So we kind of rallied around getting them groceries, checking on them and all that. So the thing is, unless, the consciousness shifts towards mental health, I don't think that, we are doing a great job of handling this pandemic, because I think mental health professionals are also frontline workers, because since day one they've been on the job. Anxiety is reigning supreme. Every call I get is of, children also asking me, like, if my mother and father die of COVID, what's going to happen to me? And this is a sixth grader, because they saw the telephone number somewhere on Facebook or something like that. So anxiety is something that scares everybody. The other thing is, like Madam said, the household chores. All of a sudden, Facebook is inundated with, exotic cooking, buns and, bread and all kinds of things. And also inundated with pictures of men cooking. Okay, did we need a pandemic to actually reverse the gender roles? It looks like, this pandemic has at least succeeded in reversing gender roles for a few people. So there are jokes on, the washing dishes, there are jokes on, doing housework, and there are so many memes that are coming up, which in a way is a good thing. That's one of the good things that came out, that if they don't revert to type, men helping out and, helping with the housework, at least in those few of those upwardly mobile khandans, I think it's a great thing. Now we're talking of the middle class, the lower middle class, and, the poverty ridden, which is more than 40 crores people in this country. And we've seen the plight of the migrants. I myself have reached out and helped feed as many as I could. The sad part is, if the civil body has to be there to help. Today the migrants are alive because of the civil body. Okay, because of all the people there, the NGOs, the voluntary workers, the volunteers, the housewives, who have kind of, cut down on their own income just to feed people from outside. I think today those migrants, owe a lot to, their own countrymen, rather than, unfortunately, the government. And it also shows that, there's a failure of the government. If the civil body has to take such an active role, it is a failure of the government. Maybe a little more planning. Like I said, this is the first time we are dealing with all this. I have never in 27 years of my life worked out of home. Never. Okay, for me, it's getting up in the morning and rushing to work and coming back late in the night, completely brain dead. Okay, so for me, it's initially it was like a vacation. For 1 week, I had no phone calls. Only people who were asking about anxiety, and nobody who wanted a consultation. And then you see the anxiety, got higher. The OCD got higher. People getting obsessed about washing. Imagine a person who already has OCD, who's already washing her hands, 50 times. Now she's washing her hands 150 times. I have people with ulcers on their hands, just showing them to me and saying, "Ma'am, please help us. We are going on and on washing the house. We don't know what to do." So you see, mental health issues, you know, it, just like your pandemic is an invisible enemy, you know, mental health is also this invisible enemy that's intruding onto your mind, making you do things, say things, think things that, you know, should not have been there in the first place. Suicide rates have increased. You might have already read that in the first 11 days of the lockdown, 92,000 cases of child abuse were reported. And these are reported cases. Please don't tell me about the unreported cases. I deal with the unreported ones. Okay. And domestic violence went up by 50%. Pornographic viewing went up by about 50 to 60%. And so you see, the PUBG, you know, it was the most downloaded game in this 2 months. Right. There's another game called Sin City, which is the most downloaded game. So these are the, you know, this is what has happened to us. Children obviously can't take sitting in front of a computer and taking classes. They're used to, like, you know, sitting in a class, you know, elbowing their classmates, throwing erasers at somebody else. You see, so the next group of people worst hit are children. How can you have an online class for a kindergarten child? Now give us a break. So, you know, we are trying our best. We are trying to do, you know, what we can given these circumstances, but give us a break. You know, a child needs to play and play with Atta and do all crazy things, right? And then you have parents who are working from home but can't indulge in that, because I think a lot of people have forgotten what parenting is, honestly, because two people going out to work to earn a living has become the norm these days. You know, very few people can survive on one income. So two people go out to work. Everybody's tired. Everybody's angry. Everybody's mega pissed off. Okay. So a child says, let's do this, let's do that. All the silly things that we did as children, playing with Atta, rolling rotis for mom, you know, making the map of Australia and mom actually making those rotis. Forgotten, completely forgotten. So for parents to even indulge their children, it's like a nightmare. I have so many parents who ring up with anxiety because the children are going to be home till September. And God knows for how long after that. Okay, children who wake up late, children who sleep late, children who are, you know, stuck to their mobile phone, parents who are stuck to their mobile phones. See, today I'm using my mobile phone at least 70% more than I normally use it. Okay, I'm constantly on my phone because I'm working from home. So you see, you know, I'm just trying to be as anecdotal as possible about this. But you see, you can understand the undercurrent. There's so many suicide attempts. The suicide rate apparently has gone up by 30%. And in the world, it's more than that. 70% divorce rates in China itself, right? So when we are talking about, you know, these statistics, just the thought of it is scary. So mental health, you know, how we are going to be able to form a sustainable model for mental health is something that we need to discuss. A sustainable model where we talk of gender equality, we talk of gender sensitization, sex education, normal education, and the new ramifications of today's education system for the next 1 year at least. And relationships where, you know, social distancing is causing, you know, a break in relationships. As it is, long distance relationships don't survive. And now you actually have a socially distanced relationship, which is very difficult to survive. And what about COVID patients, you know, COVID positive patients, ostracizing them and not letting them into even general stores to buy things. You know, the stigma that is associated now with both mental illness now, which is equal to the stigma that is now created because of COVID. So these are all considerations, and these are all things that we need to sit down and brainstorm with, you know, intellectuals like this panel and others, to be able to find a sustainable way to help and empower women and children to, you know, move past this these perils for the next 3 to 4 years. It is not going to stop now. People are saying 2 to 3 years. I'm adding 2 more years because mental health, you know, it the wave will continue.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for providing an overview on what kind of distress is it creating on homes across the world. So now that there is a lot of violence going across, what kind of impact is this pandemic creating on reproductive health and hygiene of women? I'd like to ask Poornima ma'am to also provide few systematic changes that are required in the existing healthcare system to ensure access for sexual and reproductive health and gender-based violence for women, as now the most of the importance is given to COVID-19 and sexual and reproductive health are kept aside. They're not being considered important right now. So what kind of changes are required?
So So if you've seen some, you know, very horrifying pictures on Facebook and other social media where pregnant and just delivered women are asked to sleep next to COVID positive patients for, you know, sheer paucity of beds. So now this pandemic has created a situation where every hospital is now wary of taking on any patient who knows if they're having COVID-19 or who knows if they're carriers. We've had newborn children, you know, infected with COVID-19. So actually, it's a very scary situation. The Telangana city and state police have taken up the initiative where you can, you know, do the rounds of, where the police do the rounds of victims of domestic violence. And they've, you know, what they've done is they've accumulated about 15 to 20 mental health professionals like us, and through Dial 100 we are connected to a person who's a victim of either domestic violence or alcohol based violence, because of the recent the alcohol shops being opened, there was a spate of cases. So each one of us is handling about 20 to 30 cases a day, and that's a lot actually. And then we direct them back to the police, who go there and give them, you know, at least the immediate care is taken care of, where they're given a warning, a little bit of police counseling. The police are heavily sensitized. Otherwise, there was a point wherein the, you know, a woman could go and beg in a police station, but domestic violence was considered an internal matter. Aapka andruni mamla hai, aap jao sambhalo usko. So today, we have, at least in this state, we have this awareness that says, no, domestic violence, you know, is a big no. The same thing, you know, even if a child calls, we are addressing, you know, the situation with the counseling for the child, counseling for the mother, and in trying to get the police to counsel the father, it is bring him back for counseling. So we're making about 2 or 3 follow-up calls. The same way, there's another NGO called COVID Sati, which is doing the same thing. I myself have a free WhatsApp chat line from my clinic. You know, and the Hyderabad Psychiatric Society has reached out. So, you know, keeping mental health in mind and keeping the fact that women who are deprived basic care, you know, for sexual health, menstrual health, child care, I know, and help for the time of the delivery. A lot of them are attempting self-harm and have suicidal behavior. We had a full-term pregnant woman who committed suicide because she could not get help at the right time. So these are, none of these cases actually make it to the newspapers or to the news, as we all know. So I think that a sustainable policy today is probably a dream, because it's not really possible, and it's only the private sectors which are not taking on COVID positive patients, who are not permitted to take on COVID positive patients, can actually, you know, form a group and, you know, probably subsidize their rates for such patients. And even today, I think only emergencies and emergency cesarean sections are being taken on. All elective surgeries are being postponed all over the world. I have gynecologist friends all over the world. And so I think this is the stage where, you see, and even all elective medical terminations of pregnancy are being postponed. So it's actually a rather bad situation, you know, a product of rape gets pregnant and she doesn't get help. She has to carry the child to term. So which is actually pretty traumatic for her. So along with the medical support, we are trying to offer mental health support. But, you know, at this moment, it's not a sustainable. We have a lot of ideas. We have a lot of policies in place also for it. And as Madam said, we have a lot of laws, which are wonderful laws, actually, but not being implemented. Another aspect which I would like to touch is sexual harassment at the workplace. Now, a lot of that is happening because people, you know, particularly bank employees, all those who have to go to work, nurses, bank employees, all the women in the working sector who actually have to go to work. So now, you know, what was probably a distributed act is now, you know, very consolidated onto these women, and they are complaining of a lot of, you know, sexual overtures by people, and, you know, even people on the road apparently making lewd comments where they've never faced these things before. So these are all issues where I think we need to address this, and I don't think for the next 1 year we are going to have a sustainable policy. And only if the private hospital sector actually, you know, rises to the occasion, will we have some kind of a sustainable, otherwise, you know, we are back to the NGOs, we are back to, you know, activists, we are back to people pushing for their rights rather than actually people voluntarily offering help.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for providing actually an overview on why we cannot currently come up with sustainable solutions.